On the Ebola epidemic, I'm joined now by Dr. Catherine Jacobson. She's an internationally respected health expert who has done field research in Sierra Leone. She also teaches at George Mason University in Washington, D.C. Dr. Jacobson, thanks for coming on. We appreciate your insight today. We just heard in Jessica's report that Thomas Duncan, the Dallas patient, is literally clinging for his life. He came in contact with 50 other people, 9 of those people close contact. How serious is this? Should these people be quarantined?
It is important for them to be monitored. So quarantine means that they're not sick yet, but they have had contact with someone who was. And it is important for their own safety and health that if they have become infected, that get detected as early as possible. So by quarantining them, that means that if they do fall sick, no one else will be exposed to the risk that they might pose.
Are we sure that this is not an airborne disease?
We are quite certain that there's no evidence that it is. And part of that has been seen in the case of the patient who flew to Nigeria several months ago who had Ebola. No one on the plane with him fell ill, even though he was already symptomatic. So people generally are not infectious with Ebola until they're actually sick. So the people who flew on the plane with this patient in Texas really aren't at risk. And the people who had airspace with him are also not at risk.
Regarding the doctor, Dr. Sakra, who's now back in the hospital, they say he had beat it. There have been reports that once you beat it, it can't come back. But if that's the case, why is he back in the hospital?
Ebola really weakens the whole body. And so he likely had some lung trouble, possibly pneumonia, other things that may have made him susceptible to other infections during his recovery period. So it's almost certainly not Ebola, but this is just the effect of being weak from having fought off such a severe virus.
Can the disease mutate in any way?
It is possible for the virus to mutate, and I know there's a lot of risk that people have been talking about of it going airborne. That is highly unlikely. However, the more people who have the virus, the more opportunities there are for it to mutate. So far, more than 7,000 people worldwide have been affected by this outbreak, and each of those 7,000 is an opportunity for the virus to change in some way that could make it more harmful.
They say you get it, or doctors have said you can contract it by bodily fluids. Let's say someone sneezes and you touch a workspace where they have sneezed. Is it possible to get it that way?
It could be possible. Sneezes are not very effective ways of transmitting this particular virus. Vomit or fecal matter or those sorts of things would be much more effective transmitters. So I've heard people say there's maybe a 3-foot range for a sneeze where the virus could get out. But people who have Ebola in the US will be contained very quickly and isolated so that they're not able to infect people through a sneeze or a liquid that could fall onto a surface.
Why is it spreading so quickly in West Africa? Is it because of the water system there and all of these elements are within the water system?
It's not necessarily the water system so much as the whole public health system. There's just a shortage of medical facilities, a shortage of beds for people who have various medical conditions, not enough doctors, not enough protective gear for healthcare workers. So it's a systemic problem with the medical system and the public health system that's allowing it to spread. But you're also right that not having good water for hygiene, the general lack of infrastructural development certainly plays a role.
And one last question very quickly, because we've got to go. Why the full court press in the United States with the CDC tomorrow and the President of the United States?
We want to make sure that we do as much as we can now to contain the outbreak both here in the U.S. and also in West Africa so it doesn't spread farther.
I see. Dr. Catherine Jacobson, thank you so much. Very useful information. We really appreciate it.